Okay, so I'm calling this meeting to order. This is the Committee on Public Works and Utilities for the Northampton City Council. Let's start with the roll call.
Counselor Nash.
Here.
Counselor Dwight.
Here.
Counselor Murphy.
Here.
Okay, and we have a quorum. We have any public comment? Nobody's here for public comment? Terrific. All right. The next thing on the agenda is to approve the minutes of February 27th.
I move that we do approve the minutes of February 27th.
Do I have a second?
And I second that we do approve the minutes of February 27th.
Okay, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, great. Items referred to committee. So now we have 17.264, in order to establish water sewer rates for fiscal year 2018. Should I read all this and then this, or keep reading?
Just read the order.
Okay. City of Northampton, Massachusetts, in the City Council, March 16, 2017, upon the recommendation of the mayor, I have order 0-17.264, in order to establish water and sewer rates for fiscal year 2018, ordered that effective July 1st, 2017, the per 100 cubic foot, the CCF rates for water and sewer are as follows. Water, customers with 1-inch meter or smaller, tier 1 consumption for 0 through 16 CCFs will be set at $4.36 per CCF. Tier 2 consumption for 16 CCF and graders, the rate will be set at $5.82 per CCF. Customers with meters larger than 1 inch, all consumption will be measured at $5.72 per CCF. The sewer rates for non-metered customers will be set at $7.52 per CCF based on 80% of metered water consumption, and the rates for metered customers will be set at the same price of $7.52 per CCF.
So I'll move approval to put it on the floor.
And second.
Okay, it's on the floor, and the mayor is here to speak about this.
Can I just make a note quickly that to recognize and acknowledge for public record that we have Councilor from Ward 6, Marianne LaBarge, and Councilor Large, Ryan O'Donnell, and also present.
Thank you.
And we also
have
the motion to
open. Yeah, I move that we open the public hearing.
Do we have a second? Mr. Councilor
Murphy?
Is this actually a public hearing?
Well, we were
not per the charter, unless your rules specify.
I don't think this is a public hearing.
That's fine.
So,
Councilor Donald's here as a spectator.
Yeah, well,
correct.
Yes. As long as it was advertised as a public hearing. Then I move we open the public hearing. If I don't do that, I would have opened it before I.
I actually moved that first. I'll second it then.
Yeah, I didn't know it was a.
All in favor?
There's one seat.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Okay. You're up.
I don't know. Are you able to pull up the presentation?
Yeah.
And I believe there, well, there were copies. I think that you made copies.
Yeah,
but
I do.
It's there. And we also made copies. But
presentation. Did I
email you? Email that I'll have.
Yeah, I did.
The problem is, you're not going to be able to see
it. It's okay.
It's going to be up on the
We'll
screen.
Figure it out.
Yeah. Yeah. It's in color up here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's in 3D. So I am presenting you this year the FY 2018 water and sewer rates. If you want to go to the first slide, you can. I have with me the the Director of Public Works, Donald Scalia, and of course the Finance Director, Susan Wright. I'm going to go through some slides, and then I'm going to have the director talk specifically about some of the capital projects, which is kind of the format we've used the last several years in doing these presentations. So the rates that you read, Chairman Nash, are basically the same rates that this council approved in FY 2017. And as those of you who are on the council may recall, we went through a fairly significant review process, moving from basically a single rate for water and sewer to these new tiered rates, and had significant public meetings and public feedback. And so this would be the second year using these rates. And again, we're proposing no increase for FY 2018. Now, in trying to, this is sort of an interesting presentation because we're not presenting the budget yet, because that's not till May 15th, and tomorrow you're having a hearing on the capital plan. So this will sort of turn into kind of a preview of capital, a focus on the capital program and capital spending for the Water and Sewer Enterprise Fund. And it'll also, by default, turn into a preview of sort of the big picture projection for those two enterprise fund budgets, because of course the rates are the revenue that we generate in order to fund those two enterprise funds. So if you go to the next slide, we'll show you, this is the, that's kind of cool. The first slide is really just showing water consumption. And this is a slide that looks at calendar years, because that's how our software was able to pull it out for today. And this is basically a five-year retrospective. But the key thing, and this is in millions of gallons, so you can basically see for the last 3 years, we've had a very kind of steady amount of water consumption. It's about 1 billion gallons, or 100 million, about 1 billion gallons. And this 2016 slide captures, obviously, the first half of fiscal year 2017 as well, which would have been under the new rates. And so you'll see that even during the summer and fall months of 2016, we haven't added any new customers, any major new water customers. We haven't lost any major customers. Even with some conservation efforts that we may have anticipated, it's still showing fairly stable. So that's water consumption. You can go to the next slide. So when we look at the estimated revenues, we're essentially looking at fairly level in terms of the revenues, as you would expect. The recap budget for FY 2017 shows, it sort of gives you the breakdown of the water enterprise receipts. In FY 2017, the recap budget was showing a budgeted amount of $6,027,245. We're basically budgeting less than a percentage, about $2,755 difference. Sort of rounding it up to $6,030,000. So the Enterprise Stabilization Fund, you'll see we are taking a little bit more out of the Stabilization Fund to fund capital projects in the 18 budget. That's why you see the $92,214 increase for 2018. Our water liens line item stays the same. Our water meter fee stays the same. Those are not changing as well. Cross connection, it's more of an accounting change. We have always been collecting cross connection fees. This is something that we are now being asked to show in this enterprise fund. And so that's why it kind of pops up this year, but not in 2017. We were still collecting cross connection fees. We just weren't showing it this way. And then interest, $60,000. Again, we're budgeting the same. So effectively, the water rates and charges we're projecting will stay the same, which stands to reason our consumption's been fairly constant and we're keeping the rates the same. Where you see that uptick of 1.8% is really the additional funds that we're using from stabilization to fund some of the capital projects in the budget. So you'll, and that's coming already from an already established fund. It's not new revenue. So we're just going to be utilizing some of our stabilization fund. You can go to the next slide. This shows you the budget broken out into PS, OM, OOM, and then other. And again, it sort of shows you the breakdown of where we are spending. Obviously, you can see the largest increase. You know, PS, there's some increases. Those are primarily normal salary increases that happen every year as part of collective bargaining. The other line item, this will be detailed in another slide, but that's basically showing some of the increased debt service on the borrowings that we'll be doing as part of the larger capital projects that have already been approved. And then OM, there's some slight changes, you know, 54,000. So again, when you get down to the bottom line of all that movement, it's again about a 1.8% change. So, you know, pretty much a balanced projected budget at this point in terms of the revenue we're projecting as well as the budget. That standing here today on March 27th, obviously, we're still, you know, we've still got a month and a half, but this is our best estimate in terms of setting the rates. And I don't foresee it changing very much. I don't think the state is going to come in with any brand new water money or sewer money. So this is probably fairly accurate. So now we can go to the next slide. So that's the water side. Sewer, estimated revenues for sewer. Again, we're other than sort of rounding it to a whole number, we're basically looking at similar revenues for sewer. Sewer is largely driven by water because, of course, the sewer rate is set as a percentage of consumption of water, 80% of consumption for most of the customers. Sewer liens, those are when we place liens on property related to sewer payments. So we're showing that as the projected revenue, and then interest income, again, $40,000. So slightly less moving parts in the sewer enterprise fund. But the bottom line in this one is we're projecting about a $1,872 difference, which on a $6 million budget shows up as 0% because it's such a small number. I don't know where how far out the decimal point goes, but effectively it's the same. So that's the estimated revenue for sewer. If we go to the next slide, we can show the preliminary sewer enterprise fund budget. Again, you can see the breakdown. PS, you can see a relatively small increase in the PS line. A slight decrease in OM, a decrease in OOM, and then other, which again includes debt service, largely, and that's going up as we're taking on more of those larger projects, which you'll hear about later. Again, the difference that we're estimating is $1,872, which is actually going down 0.03%. So it's not quite a zero, it's like slightly below zero. So that's the preliminary sewer enterprise fund budget. If you go to the next slide, we've got some kind of historical numbers, which kind of shows you over the last 5 years how that PS, OM, OOM, and then the other, which is, as I've said before, is the debt service. And also, the other piece I didn't mention was it's also part of the contribution to stabilization fund, because as you know, we've come up with kind of a plan for taking retained earnings and putting it into our stabilization fund to build that up for projects. So the big takeaway from this slide, I think, is the major kind of moving piece when you look at 17 and 18, or the thing that's expanded the most, is the red. And the red is basically the OOM, the capital projects. It's for the infrastructure projects. It's for equipment. It's basically the infrastructure projects that we're ramping up, water lines, the work at the wastewater treatment plant, primarily water lines. You'll see the similar ramp up in the sewer budget. So that gives you the 5-year comparison and what's changed. You know, you can see the lowest line. is, you know, sort of a fairly, the lower two boxes are kind of moving along, the PS and OM are kind of moving along at a fairly stable rate with normal increases, but really the big change is the OOM. You can go to the next line. This is a similar chart that shows you the five-year historicals for sewer, PS, OOM, other. And again, you saw in 18, the red and the blue, the OM, which are for, you know, capital projects and obviously the debt service and other capital related projects. Those are the ones that are kind of expanding as we ramp up some of the projects we've been talking about. And again, this is work at the wastewater treatment plant. This is other sewer line replacement and other things that you see in the capital improvement program and that the director will talk about in a little bit. So that kind of shows you the historicals. Next slide. I'm now going to turn it over to Director LaScaglia to talk about capital, kind of the capital program. So this is kind of a preview of your hearing tomorrow night, but it's really focusing on sort of the five-year projection of the kinds of projects that they're looking at. And this is all stuff that's in the capital program that you have. But I'm going to have her just kind of talk about some of the highlights, as well as kind of the plan for how some of these will be implemented. So turn it over to the director.
Good afternoon. So this is a snapshot of the capital plan for the water enterprise. And I'll start by saying I've been with the DPW for about a year now. We also have a new city engineer, a new water superintendent. So this was a really good opportunity for all of us to get together and look at what we had for projects in queue, encumbered funds, reports and studies that had been done over the previous five years by the previous leadership at the DPW, and take a really good hard look at what we had, what our capacity is, and what our plan should be. And we've spent the better part of the year putting this together, and that's what you see in front of you. So a lot of thought has gone into this, a lot of time has gone into this. We've taken a lot of variables into account in what do we have for projects in queue right now that we're working on right now. What is the construction you're going to see, you know, on Hinckley Street in 2 months from now, versus what is our capacity to push forward in the next 1 to 5 years. So the result of that process is kind of this spreadsheet that you see in front of you. So I'll just go through here and hit the high points, since it's not a capital presentation, but just to kind of talk about what were our biggest things in creating this budget. One of the biggest things we have to look at is water line replacement. So our most important, among our most important infrastructure is water lines. So what we are asking for FY18 is to fund Damon Road. So as many of you probably know, there's a significant reconstruction of Damon Road that's going to happen on the tip. We're working with MassDOT, so the schedule is sort of variable, but it's moving along. And we hope to be to construction in a timely manner, which is looking like spring of 2019. So this money that you see here is primarily for construction new water infrastructure on Damon Road. We have already funded the design work for that, so we have encumbered funds that we'll be paying for the design work associated with Damon Road. So this is for construction on Damon Road, as well as proposed construction on Vallone Drive. So I will also mention that we have a water asset management plan that was created in 2013 by our consultants Taylor and Howard. So in that plan, we have areas that have been identified in the city for future projects. And we need to marry that study with sewer system studies that we have, stormwater assessment, our roadway assessment, and we need to bundle this work, this infrastructure work together in a way that makes sense, because we don't obviously want to be digging up the road multiple times. We want to do it all together. So in terms of projections, when you look at these numbers, we have a really good handle on what we want to do for FY18, and we just have sort of initial projections of what we want to do beyond that, but those numbers are sort of variable and will harden up as we get closer. But for FY18, that's a really good number. In terms of reservoir construction, we have known deficiency in the spillways of our three drinking water reservoirs, so Ryan Mountain and West Waitley. This money that you see over the next 5 years is projected expenditures based on 2013 numbers for permanent repairs to spillways. So we have insufficient spillway capacity. And we are looking at roughly $10 million over the next 5 to 7 years to address those deficiencies. So this is a funding strategy for the design and construction work associated with addressing those deficiencies. A few other things that I'm sure you're familiar with some of these items, and I'm happy to answer questions, but I'll just kind of hit the items of note here. The Audubon Road water tank repairs. This is a 200,000-gallon storage tank that's part of the Weeds Village high-pressure system. It was constructed in 1935, and it needs sandblasting and painting, as well as security fencing and ladder guards that are going to be required by the regulatory authority. Electrical and electronic upgrades to control systems. So again, this is part of a funding strategy for long-term repair and rehabilitation of the tank. And the last item on here that is of note is the transmission main rehabilitation and replacement. So we have two transmission mains right now that run from the water treatment plant into town. One of them runs through a swamp. It's the wetland near the Beaver Brook. So it's a 20-inch cross-country line that is largely inaccessible, and it is more than 100 years old. Something that was identified in the water asset management plan as having sort of a critical nature to starting to pay attention to design and relocation and reconstruction of it. So the ultimate goal is to make this a phased project where we will take this line and move it to the road. So it's going to run right down Route 9, basically to the corrosion control building, in proximity to our other transmission main that runs in a similar location. So that way we can get at it if we have a problem. So this is going to be a phased project over many years. To give you an idea of the scope, we're looking at 20,200 linear feet of 24-inch ductile iron that we are building basically from scratch, and then we will abandon the existing line. The $250,000 that you see for FY18 is to get us started, and the way we are going to start is by identifying and exercising existing valves. We need to make sure that they work, so it's basically a valve exercising program, if you will, to find the valves, make sure they work, that way we can sectionalize portions of the line, kind of have an assessment of, does this valve hold, does it not hold? What do we need to do to make it hold? If we find a problem, fix it immediately. So that's our first priority, is to just kind of assess what we've got. And then we can move to actually do a more thorough design for the actual construction of this. So that's the high points of the water enterprise budget. You can move to the next slide. So this next slide is for the sewer enterprise. So this talks about the treatment side as well as the collection system. So the big ticket item on here is the wastewater treatment plant improvements. So this is obviously a project of considerable scale and scope. And one of the things that we've done in the past year is to take a look at what we think is a good schedule and a good pace of work what our internal capacity is to manage this and what we think, going off of the priorities that Kleinfelder has laid off for us, what do we think is a good process to follow here. So we've done a very careful review of this, and I think it would be helpful to let you know where we are now and where we're going. So we currently have a designer on board, Ty and Bond, engineering firm, is actually very close to finalizing documents to go out to construction for the conversion of our chlorine gas disinfection to hypochlorite. This is what we're using to disinfect the effluent, and we are looking to have this entire project complete by the end of FY18, and this is going to use existing funds that we already have. Additionally, we're doing some other, I'll call them discrete projects that aren't necessarily tied to the whole plant, but are tied to sort of the sludge processing, if you will. We're doing sludge pump replacement, some gas detection, and replacement of the permanganate feed tank, which is actually used for odor control. So that's a worthy project. And this work is all going to be done using existing funds that we have. So we sort of look to pick off discrete projects that we could do immediately, that were kind of, you know, good solid projects that were going to have some really good benefit to the plant. So that's what we're doing right now. By the end of FY17, well, let me back up. We have to work under procurement rules for Massachusetts general laws. So we have to hire an owner's project manager. And that is going to be our representative kind of on the ground to help the city interact with designer and the folks doing construction. It's just sort of our eyes and ears on the ground. And we hope to have this person on board by the end of FY17. And the biggest thing that they're going to do is to help us to create documents that will help us to hire a design services, a designer, to give us design services for the next big group of projects that we're going to do. And those projects are going to be electrical and HVAC upgrades. So when we think about what's the next 5 years going to look like here, we need to do a wholesale revamping of the electrical infrastructure at the wastewater treatment plant. We need to start at the utility pole and work our way in. One of the biggest problems we have there is what you would call like dirty power. And it's sort of wreaking havoc with the sophisticated electronics that are needed to run the plant. So we need to start outside and work our way in. And that's going to be kind of the big ticket item that we need to address next. So, you know, it's great because we can pick off, you know, this disinfection system and some pumps right now, but this is where we need to focus our energy. In terms of timing, when we look at what we have for the work going on, we feel that this schedule of expenditures represents what we think is a really good, realistic time schedule. The other thing I'll mention that's on here that is of interest is sewer system studies. So this is part of the comprehensive wastewater management plan. We talk about infiltration and inflow, which is making the flows in the plant higher than they should be because we're getting water in the plant that's actually not wastewater. So in terms of investigating this, there's a huge benefit to the city to try to arrest this water from entering the system before we actually have to pay to treat it. One of the areas that we know is at issue there is the neighborhood between King and Street and State Street, and that's in proximity to the King Street Court. So this could include like Center Street, Masonic, Gothic. The other place we'll be looking at is off Pleasant Street, Kirkland Alpha alleyway. Have some infiltration there. So this, we're asking for funding to just kind of finish off some studies that are already out there, but this will just kind of wrap them up and put a bow on it so we can come up with sort of a strategy and know, okay, this is exactly what we need to do. The last thing I'll mention is sewer line replacement. The next place we're targeting is Damon Road, so it's part of that infrastructure project. We're going to be replacing the sewer line there, and then we'll be moving to other areas as necessary. So that's the high points of the sewer enterprise.
Thank you. Question?
Yeah, Donna, particularly relative to the sewer and the wastewater treatment plant, your holistic approach is actually appreciated in that recognizing that whatever, I'm assuming that you acknowledge and recognize that whatever you affect now may have an impact on future projects. And so you're trying to synergistically make it work as opposed to make something you have to tear apart later. And at least that was the gist of what I got from your description. So I'm heartened by that. The issue of water filtration, some of it also is related to the antique clay pipes that we have that tend to basically work as, they'll channel anything that runs through it, if provided it's not clogged, but they're not centered here. They're more in the outlying areas, as I understand, too, up around Barrett Street and around there. Is there any discussion about trying to mitigate those?
We have multiple areas of the city that have been studied. The last kind of missing piece of this is the downtown area that I talked about. So we have good documentation really across a lot of the city that is going to give us the information we need. I can't speak specifically to the area you've referenced, but we should have a pretty good handle on this when complete.
And the ones you identified are places with impermeable surfaces all over the place. So I can see the concentration might create a problem. One last question relative to the elimination of the water line that's running through Beaver Brook right now. So that will eventually be abandoned. There'll be no mitigation. There's not going to be a requirement to go into this kind of delicate wetlands to...
That's going to be part of the permitting process. When I say abandoned, I mean we will not be using it for our benefit.
Right.
So what the permitting will require remains to be seen, whether we need to remove it or, you know, there's some, you know, we can sort of cap it and walk away. We'll be up to the permitting authorities.
I would imagine removal would be substantially more expensive than just deadheading it, and then because of all the permitting that's associated with trying to pull out a pipeline of that size and dimension out of protected wetlands. I'd imagine that's going to create a significant uptick in anticipated costs in these things.
So. You are correct. So ultimately, that's up to the permitting authority.
Scuba gear on next year's capital.
Other things. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. And just to follow up on the wastewater treatment plant, that's why we selected the projects we selected this year. We wanted to make sure they were discrete projects. You know, we can do these three things and it's not going to affect the rest of the work we're doing,
right,
or vice versa. And that was why we picked these off. They're of great benefit. And, you know, we're not going to have to tear it out, you know, 10 years from now.
Is there anything structurally at the wastewater treatment plant that would need to be dealt with beyond a complete overhaul of the HVAC and the electrical? That's all, I mean, the structure itself, is that?
The structure itself is fairly sound. There's a few areas where the roof is sort of difficult, but structurally, it's generally solid.
And it's got a useful life beyond the 2020 budgeting period?
The roof or the whole plan?
The whole system, yeah.
Yeah, I think the whole system, you know, there are structural things that were identified in the CWMP that we need to look at. But in terms of, you know, does the building need to be torn down? The answer is no.
Okay. Last question, I'm sorry.
Sure.
A lot of what it inspired us, in fact, creating stormwater management fee, for instance, was pressure from federal authorities because we weren't necessarily meeting new requirements and standards. And it's the same reason we developed the water treatment system, so that once upon a time we were able to function with an open reservoir in the APA. It changed conditions and standards that required us to build a rather expensive system. Yeah, in the scheme of things, the way things look now, I don't imagine that we're going to be receiving many edicts from the EPA anytime soon. But how much of this is compelled by EDA or mandates as opposed to enlightened self-interest as a community in trying to protect itself and its infrastructure.
I think it's a good solid combination. You know, I can't assign a percentage to it. You know, I can stand here and tell you as far as stormwater goes, it's largely permit driven. You know, as well as sort of our general
regulatory
awareness.
Right, regulatory permit.
Right, regulatory
permit.
Yeah.
The EPA permit
yeah.
that we get, yeah.
Right, that I knew, yeah, that's why I knew what you were saying, so yes.
But in terms of you know, treating effluent, you know, the permit is what the permit is, the
right.
EPA says what the EPA says. You know, I think there's a good awareness on the city's part that we need to maintain our infrastructure, obviously, but we also have, you know, permitted rules that we have to follow. So I think it's a good mix, though I wouldn't be willing to put a percentage
okay.
on it.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Okay. And then the last slide, of course, is we're back to the water and sewer rates. Thank you very much, and I do want to thank the director and her new team, really. There's a lot of new folks that she's put together, and they really have spent a lot of time going through a lot of the documents that were, you know, a lot of the studies that were done, as well as looking at where projects were. The piece about having to hire the project manager, I mean, literally, because of the level of expenditure, this is basically a building project. It's as if we're building a school or a police station or something. I mean, that's the scope, which is why we have to actually go out to bid first to get a building project manager. So that's added a whole other layer of complexity, but that's just, we have to abide by state contracting law. The other thing I would say to the, you know, regulatory versus, you know, just making sure the plant is upgraded and, you know, obviously the age of the plant. I don't know if any of you saw the Boston Globe over the last few days, but a major water treatment plant in the Washington State area basically had a catastrophic malfunction and raw sewage. Millions of gallons of raw sewage were pumped into Puget Sound, which I'm assuming is going to be a very expensive. They didn't have anything in the article about penalties or fines, but suffice it to say, it's going to be a really expensive. So I mean, that's the main thing is we're, you know, that it's basically an environmental protection system between the river and our toilets and other sewage devices. So. We're mandated to do it not only because of the regulations, but just because we're trying to protect the local ecosystem. So that's the quick presentation. Obviously, not as long and wonky as last year. We had consultants and we had, you know. So again, this will be the second year with the new rate structure. We're not seeing anything significant happening. I won't say anything smart. I haven't heard of any massive, you know, bankruptcies or foreclosures or people leaving en masse. I think the new system has worked out well for people, and so we're going to have another year with these rates and we'll reassess.
Yeah, actually, I'll defer to someone who hasn't asked a question.
So, if you're closing the presentation, I think we want to next hear from any opponents in the room and then any proponents. And then open it up to committee members. So,
okay.
Are there any opponents in the room who would like to speak at this time? All right. Are there any proponents? I think I got that backwards.
Yes.
So, questions from Councilor LeBar?
Thank you. Mayor, I want to thank you. I want to thank Susan Wright and Donna and all your staff for putting in such a wonderful, wonderful whole report on what is occurring for the next 5 years, hopefully. But I don't think that people really realize how much needs to be done in the city with the water and sewer. And I think they're going to be very pleased because the mayor did hold back the increase a year ago, and people were so happy because it was such bad timing. And I think now they are going to be very pleased to hear that. Thank you, Mayor.
You're welcome. Thank you. Councilor Joy.
Okay, I think it was 2 years ago, held back as a word to allow for us to readjust the formula. which is where we got the most public participation, the marked difference between the attendance at this hearing versus the one, the many that we had relevant talking about the restructuring, the formula. To that, you had hinted to this. I was wondering, community pushback or feedback, just as importantly, given the new rates. In fact, actually, as I understand it, the rates for most people, most residential property owners, actually stayed the same or went down. Mm-hmm. And I think the reason that we probably aren't seeing many people here is because it's status quo, mm-hmm. is the projection, so that we wouldn't get as much pushback. Some of the concerns that were expressed among, well, former counselors and some business owners, with the, as you said, with this would have a dilatory impact on the ability for businesses to exist and thrive. I know we heard from one landlord downtown at one point who suggested that this was onerous. I haven't heard from him since as to once it's been implemented how onerous it is. Mm-hmm. I think he suggested that when he was asked to lease a property, the first thing they asked about was the water bill, which struck me as strange, given the fact that the rent was pretty high. But have you, in your office, and you would be the receiving point, heard from any more businesses or individuals, yay or nay, relative to the water rates, water and sewer rates?
We have not. Again, it's never been a focal point when we talk to people. New businesses, typically they're more concerned about taxes, which obviously are a much larger percentage of somebody's operating costs for a business. When the rates first went into effect, we had done a calculator that allowed people to kind of see, but even after the rates went into effect, we did do some continued public outreach or education, primarily from tenants who contacted us, who were wanting to really understand what was happening with their rates, because they may have had leases or triple net arrangements with people and were being told that their water and sewer were going up. And so we were able to provide some useful information to people about what the real effects are. Because in many cases, particularly downtown businesses, unless you were a large commercial entity that had large infrastructure, you really weren't going to see major increases. And much of the infrastructure, even for a condo on Main Street, has 5/8-inch lines, which are like a residential line. So there, when people really drill down and got to see and do the comparison, so that those are the kinds of things we did with people. But I have not heard. I have not heard any complaints. It's not come up in any of our discussions with any potential new businesses that have looked at it. And again, I think as the consultants have made clear, looking back at decades of historical data, no study has ever been done that's shown that water and sewer rates have driven a business out of business. There's lots of other reasons. So I think what we've seen so far has held true to that. Clearly, I know that there were some concerns expressed about housing and apartments, and I don't think we've seen any change of anything. We've seen additional units of housing and affordable housing being proposed downtown. I don't think there's been any abatement in that or anyone changing their strategy. So far, so good. It's obviously, we try to communicate with our residents and our ratepayers the value of this, what they're investing in. I know last year we showed a slide to people that basically showed what people pay for a cell phone. People will happily pay $100, $125, $150, $200 for a cell phone with all the bells and whistles and data plans and all that and telephones and electrical, but water and sewer, which some might argue is more vital, a utility, there's sometimes a disconnect. So I'm hopeful that we've been able to show, especially with the great work on the capital program, the vital nature of some of these upgrades that we're trying to pay for.
Surely you're not trying to invoke Jason Chaffetz's
comparison of health. No, I am not. I don't think I said iPhone. Did I say iPhone? No, I did not. No, I did not say that.
Right.
I think that's completely fine.
Thank you.
Not asking people to choose water, clean water over
an iPhone.
No.
Okay.
But just pointing out that it's a utility, and it's a critical utility, and, you know, just like the electricity or the cable or any of the other things that people pay for, it's a critical utility.
Well, one that certainly became evident when we had the discussion about rates, one that's taken very much for granted, mm-hmm. one that's presumed, mm-hmm. and everyone presumes that they're going to go to their tap and turn it on, and clean water is going to come out. Mm-hmm. It's never even given the second thought. You only, mm-hmm. if it comes out murky or something, that's when you express.
And of course, when we were having that discussion last year, we hadn't yet seen the case study in Flint, Michigan, of what happens when you cut corners and decide you're going to save money and tap a river you hadn't been using and not spend any money on corrosion control in the process, and then you basically destroy your drinking water system for an entire city, metropolitan area.
Which is also a reason why it's important, as Don referred to, the holistic approach, mm-hmm. and systematically go and recognize the various projects that you're doing, the impacts that they have on projects further down the line. Mm-hmm. I'm very appreciative of that way of thinking. Thank you.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Also, we've been joined by Councilor Sciarra. All right. I have a quick question. So the work at the water treatment plant, will it be less smelly?
He lives near it.
I have one neighbor in particular who would love me to report that the work going on is going to make things less smelly.
Well, I mean, the goal is always to make sure that the systems are working properly. And you mentioned the tank, that one tank in particular. That is obviously, it's a delicate chemistry experiment that goes on down there every day. And Jim Zimmerman and his group, work hard to try to maintain all of the proper balances and to try to avoid odor. And so, to the extent that we're upgrading equipment and we're able to operate things more effectively and more effective electronic equipment, the chlorination, the change in that, and then the other upgrades, I think those can only help that issue.
Okay.
No guarantee. Would you concur with that?
I would concur.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Okay.
So, no more questions.
I move we close the public hearing.
I'll second that.
All in favor say aye.
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 Okay. The public hearing has been closed. Do we want to make a recommendation to council on about those new rates?
I'd move we return a positive recommendation on holding the rates as presented.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 All right, thank you. The last item we have on here are plans for future meetings, updates, and discussion. In April, we have the stormwater and flood control utility system on the agenda. I spoke with Councilor Bidwell before he headed out of town, and he's hoping to speak with you, Mayor, about putting together, what you'll be presenting next month.
Can he say what he was proposing to?
He mentioned it to me very generally, but we haven't really had a deeper conversation about it. So I'll have to learn more about what he's expecting.
I think is what.
Because obviously the director came and did a fairly comprehensive presentation to the full council. So I'll have to understand what else that he'd like to talk about. So.
Okay.
Yep. So when he gets back, I can check with him on that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then in May, we have on the agenda National Infrastructure Week and Public Works Appreciation. So we had talked about maybe doing some tours and things, or?
Also recall there was proposed dunking booth at the sewage treatment plant.
We did have conversations with Councilor Bidwell about this, and the Department of Public Works is going to, as it has every year for the past, I don't know how many years, you know, we'll be recognizing Public Works Week. Mm-hmm. So there's two different weeks, and right. oddly enough, they happen concurrently, one week and then the other week. Public Works Week is more a, you know, municipal slash county public works infrastructure kind of week. Infrastructure Week is a national, if you go to their website, the board is made up of, like, you know, Boeing, and it's like, it's sort of like the big eye Donald Trump infrastructure that he's talking about, versus the public works and public works infrastructure, which is what we've tended to focus on. And so, so I would not, you know, if this committee wants to have an Infrastructure Week celebration, go for it. But I really think it's better to focus on one week, and the department's going to be focusing on Public Works Week, and in discussions with the director, one aspect of that will be tours, which have been done in previous Public Works Weeks, and trying to set up some tours. So I know when I talked to the chair, he indicated that once we got those scheduled, that he would work with the committee to try to promote those. I know he's done some already with his people in his ward. So I don't know so much that, as we've discussed this, that he's expecting that the committee is going to organize something, but more just help promote it once we get closer to that time.
I like that idea.
Okay, yeah, so we would try to set up during Public Works Week, and I usually come to the council and have a proclamation that we do, and there's usually American Public Works Association does a poster every year celebrating the week, and so we usually have that displayed at City Hall, and then we'll be doing some tours of various facilities. So we'll be publicizing that once we get closer. That's the plan.
I personally think we can offset your OM by having donkey booths with counselors placed over the
tent. That's possible.
I think you could get people from miles around.
That's very possible. Okay.
I volunteer, Councilor.
Okay. It's in the duties of vice chair, right?
Yes. Emphasis on duty.
Well, I do know that there's a number of people down in Ward 3 who are interested in touring both the water facility and the wastewater facility. So
okay.
They're looking forward to
that. Excellent.
Do we have any new business? Okay. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
You do.
And a second.
All in favor say aye.
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 Thank you. Give my apologies for adjourning.